This is Gary Atensi with CNTV, and today we're in Broomfield, Colorado. I am here at 3D Printing Colorado. Since 1989, they have been specializing in 3D printing, 3D scanning, equipment and services. This is a brand new division for you guys, really just a couple years in. Have a lot of experience here. Really, this is a family business for you. Share with me, Nick, a little bit how it is. Your father got involved in this and how you've continued.
Sure. Well, we started a business, like we said, in 1989, and we started looking to see how we might grow and expand the business and diversify the business a little bit. And in doing so, we read a lot of books and saw a lot of videos, including Peter Diamandis, and he would talk about exponential technologies. One of those technologies would be 3D printing. And we started doing some research on companies and research on manufacturers, and we learned that business model is very similar to the business model we already had in place.
That is fantastic. Speaking of technology, we live in basically an advanced technology society. Kind of exciting that we can experience something that really is a game changer. I mean, quite honestly, 3D printing is exciting to basically educate and introduce this to consumers out there.
Yeah, absolutely. It allows large companies and small companies and even individuals to create new products and bring products to the market much, much quicker.
Much quicker. I mean, I know for myself growing up, I was pretty excited when they came out with regular printers. I mean, quite honestly, being able to print something, I didn't have to put up a sign, hand write it anymore. Yet, everybody knew what that was going to do for us. I think 3D printing is a little bit more complex. We really have to think outside of the box as to how this can affect us, how it can affect our industries. Is that where you guys really try to educate?
It's a scenario in which people have an idea in their head and they don't necessarily know how to create a product. And so they'll bring us in and we'll help them soup to nuts, create an idea from their head to a physical product.
Let's start off first of all with 3D printing 101 for the viewers out there. Why don't we share what a 3D printer does? I mean, what's really going on?
At its simplest level, it does a series of 2D prints on top of each other, making it's additive manufacturing.
One of the things that I see is the fact that the question everybody's got to ask is, what kind of material are we talking about? Is this plastic? Is it metal? Is it nylon? Is it, I mean, it looks like ABS or all of the above?
All of the above. There's over hundreds of different materials that you can print in now, including stainless steel, nylon, ABS, rubber-like materials, soluble stuff.
I mean, when I look around here, we were pretty excited when 2D printing got going. You had black and white photos, then we got a little bored with those, went into color. Are we talking about color 3D printing as well?
We've got color parts right here. These are great for learning design concepts.
This is really a new technology when you think about it. You've been doing it here for a couple years. Although it's a new technology, I think companies understand the game changer here. So a lot of people are getting involved. There probably are already hundreds of printers that people can choose from out there, companies can choose from. That has to be kind of overwhelming for them, not knowing which printer is right for me, what material is right. Really, this is an education process for you that you're able to help those companies match up with what's best.
We try and work the process backwards and understand what the end result that the customer is trying to have and design a solution from the end back.
From the end back. I mean, share with me a little bit some of the we're talking about different applications, different sizes of companies. You've got everything from desktop printers, benchtop printers, professional printers. Tell me a little bit how that differs.
Printers range in prices from anywhere from $300 to well over $1 million. And it depends on the size of build plate that you want to have, if you're going to have a part that's fairly small, and how accurate parts need to be, and then what materials you can print in.
So we're talking about if a company out there needs basically just to print some initial prototypes, you can set them up in a printer accordingly. What about for companies out there that really need a production printer? Do you also carry those as well?
3D printing is no longer just for prototyping anymore these days. Within that, hundreds of materials, many of them are end-use applications. There's dozens, if not more than that, parts on many of the Bell helicopters and other functional pieces you'll see out there every single day.
I know as a photographer for many years, I was pretty excited when I was able to print a 4x6 print in my hand. Didn't have to go down to the local drugstore, wait a week. I was soon kind of bored with that. Before you knew it, I was printing up large scale format. Tell me about 3D printing. Are we limited to handheld, or are we talking some pretty big size pieces?
Well, there's a lot of ways to get to big pieces. One of them, one printer in of itself can print an entire dashboard of a vehicle in one print. If you're trying to get a bigger piece and you have a smaller printer, you can build them in a piece here and a piece here and assemble them together.
This really is an industry that requires a lot of education because it's new to a lot of companies out there. What your team really does is specialize in educating those folks, really hands-on. We're talking about demos. These are all things that you can provide.
So, like I said, we do things soup to nuts. Not everybody can afford to buy the printer that suits what their needs are. And so we do services as well, where people will send us their files and we'll print them for them. And so they don't have to spend $100 or $200 or $300,000 on a machine. They can buy their part. Or same thing on the scan side as well.
Let me ask you this, as far as this is a place where they can buy their machine here. What about repair here? Is this a buy here, service here, the full package?
The full package. We do sales, we do service, we do on-demand parts printing, and we do on-demand service scanning as well. So people will send us parts to scan, or we'll go on to their site and do scans for them.
Let me ask you this. I understand the output here. I understand you've got a CAD drawing, you've got something in a computer, you've got an idea right here. It ends up outputting out to an actual item you can touch. Now let's talk about the reverse of that, which is, like you mentioned before, scanning. Basically scanning printers, scanners that you're able to provide for people. This is getting pretty popular in the industry right now, especially for engineers and that type.
The reverse engineering is becoming more and more popular with the advancement of technology. We have people come in all the time that where they've taken foam and wood and glue and made a part, and they want to digitize that so they can start the process of manufacturing. And so we can scan their homemade prototype and turn it into a digital file.
That's kind of exciting. I mean, we're able to basically digitize a 3D object, take it into a computer, take it into a CAD, manipulate it, edit it, and then output it out for printing, or like you said, even just for inspection or analysis has to be a great tool.
There's lots of reasons why you might do a prototype. You might have fit checks, you might have design that you want to take a look at, and you may actually want to make an end-use part.
I mean, I'm amazed at all the different type of industries that affects. We're talking about industrial design, manufacturing, even art design. I mean, what used to take weeks in geometry is now really taking you guys hours to really push the ball forward and get things going.
We turn parts around next day, and sometimes in some situations, same day. Just depends on the size of the part and the technology that needs to be printed in.
Wonderful. Not only are you taking care of the hardware for folks out there, but also you pretty much have to be very well versed when it comes to software. What are some of the softwares that you're able to use here that run the machines?
Well, each machine has its own software that operates the machine itself. Generally, to print a file, you're working on an STL file. We also offer software. We offer the entire Geomagic suite. We offer Space Claim. We offer DesignWorks. And a whole suite of software, again, to help take products soup to nuts.
Excellent. Speaking of the software out there, is this something that is pretty user-friendly? What kind of training comes involved with that?
Well, all across the board. Some things are easier to use than others, and absolutely, everything that we sell comes with training involved.
Let me ask you this. Is 3D printing something you decided to venture out into, basically? You've been involved in the industry. Was this kind of a natural progression for you to kind of move into this?
Yeah. I had been in a different industry and saw the potential of this industry several years, so I took an opportunity to take a position within 3D a couple of years ago.
Is the technology itself, is it advancing pretty rapidly? I mean, when I look at some of this stuff, this is pretty detailed. I mean, this isn't some raw pieces here.
Right, so we represent 3D Systems as our main supplier for 3D printers. They have over 7 different technology platforms that they work with, 150 different materials. The technology is really not changing that much. What's changing in the industry is the amount of materials that can run through the printers, the different types of materials, and also the size of the parts. The base tech has been around since about 1985. And they're just kind of expanding on what's already kind of out there.
Speaking of expanding, obviously this is going into a little bit more mainstream now. That's why your typical viewer out there would think this is a new technology. Right. But like you said, if you've researched it, looked at it, and found out that the basic is still the same, what are some of the materials that you're using that it's able to basically bring the detail to the product like it does?
So some of the materials that we work with are ABSs, ABS-like acrylics, nylon 12s, we get into some of the metals, cobalt chromes, titaniums, things like that. Each different printer has different tolerances and accuracy. Something like this off of our ProJet 3500 can get down to 16 micron resolution, which is the highest in the industry currently.
And so the material itself, I mean, if a person wanted to create something like an exhaust system off of a motorcycle, mm-hmm. I mean, you can pretty much set that up and do it. How heat tolerant is some of this, and how does that work?
So I don't have the stats in front of me, but there are several materials in the SLS and SLA category of 3D printers that specifically in, say, the SLS, where it's a nylon 12 base, but they also have aluminum-filled nylons, glass-filled nylons that can go high temp. Specifically, there's a material in SLA called Bluestone that can get up to about 250C, somewhere in that range. It's a high-temp material.
If you have a company out there that basically knows the need of this, understands in-house how important it is, yet they're leery of basically breaking out and finding out what company to team up with, what would you tell them?
I mean, go with, I'd look at all the printers in the market. We always tell people to get demos from competitive products because we believe in our products. So you want to look for experience. Techs are important. 3D printers are just like any machine, they break down. So you want to have the best techs in the market servicing your printers, and we feel we have those techs here.
You have a pretty nice balance here in the company because you're able to offer the hardware, able to offer the software for those companies that need it, yet at the same time for the companies that don't have that need, you're able to provide the services. Is this something that that you're trying to get the word out and let a lot of folks that you know that you do here?
We started the services part of this business about a year ago because we saw an opportunity with customers that don't necessarily know if there's going to be a return on investment for a $500,000 piece of equipment. So they were a little bit scared to jump into the market. So we offer all of the printers that we sell, we offer the services for those printers and all of the materials that are available. So customers can buy parts for 3 months, 6 months, and we'll say, you know, this is how much you've spent in 6 months. Here's what your monthly payment looks like. It's time for you to buy your own piece of equipment. So we kind of ease people into the 3D printing market.
That is kind of nice to offer here locally. I mean, we've become a very high-tech society. We're kind of losing the high touch on it. Mm-hmm. This is something you're able to come in, feel the item, if
right.
you will,
right.
play with the machine, and I mean, understand what it's going to do before you jump in.
There are national resellers of printing services, but they don't give the opportunity for the customer to come in and touch and feel different materials and see if it's the right fit for their product.
Let me take a look. Viewers, take a look at the bottom of the screen right there. What you're going to see, first of all, is their website. On the website, take a look at the basically all the different type of hardware they offer out there. Like we said before, everything from desktop to benchtop. We're talking about production printers. You name it, they're basically going to sit down with you, have a consultation. It's nice to have basically a 3D printing team in your corner. We're talking about partnering up with you, making sure that you are getting the proper equipment you need. Obviously, if you want to come on in, the way to get this done is be educated, go through a demo. Take a look at the different applications that you can take a look at right there as well. Industrial, we're talking about healthcare, science, education, art design. These are all industries that have already benefiting from this type of work. You mentioned earlier that not only is this a product company, but this is a service company. I mean, obviously, not everybody needs a printer sitting on their in-house for them. So if somebody needs actually printing done, they can send over a file, consult with you, and out the door.
Sometimes they may not even have a file, they just have an idea. We can help them create that file as well.
And same thing goes with scanning. I mean, if somebody's got an item out there, they want to bring it in, get it scanned, or even maybe, like you say, sometimes I imagine some of the scanning's pretty big items. What is the largest item you're able to go to there?
Well, we scan vehicles all the time. We've scanned the side of a C-130 aircraft. They can go pretty big.
One of the things that I see here is if your dad thinks back to when you guys were at the educational process of growing up, It's kind of amazing the industry you guys are in right now. I mean, who would have ever thought you could have taken an idea out of your head or out of a computer and actually printed it, put it right in your hand? Is this exciting for both of you to kind of be venturing on it together?
Yeah, I tell you, we learn new things from our customers every single day about what designs they have or what they want to do with this technology. And so it is a lot of fun. It's exciting to come into work every single day. And we just get a lot of joy of helping customers create and design products.
Not only is it a game changer, but it's a time saver. I mean, what used to take a long time just to model things, just to measure them, I mean, you're now able to do them in a fraction of that time. We're talking about 3D printed parts on demand. Take a look at the bottom of the screen. Their contact information is right there. That is 3D Printing Colorado, a division of Laser Concepts. This is Gary Atensi with CNTV. And if you don't know, now you know. This is Gary Atensi with CNTV, and today we're in up northern Colorado. We are here at the Gateway of Colorado in Wellington. We're at the Old Colorado Brewing Company. Since 1989, this family tradition, generations were born to brew, have been brewing up some great taste and also tapping into some great history. Let me ask you guys a little bit about yourselves, first of all. When is it when you two got involved and decided to push the vision forward?
Well, when I met Brandon, his lifelong dream was to reopen his family's brewery. So his dream became my dream. It's been his lifelong. So just in
lifelong dream, something to open up a place. I mean, that's pretty much the American dream as it is, but open up a brewery, even cooler. How far back do you remember, Brandon, where love of brew and the love of business would come together?
You know, working with my dad and my grandpa at the brewery in early 89, 90, I really like hanging out with them and actually working with them, cleaning vessels, brewing, trying to get in there and help them out with whatever I could. And I loved it from day one, honestly. It was such a good time.
That is very cool. I mean, quite honestly, here in Colorado, we are known for our microbreweries. We're known for beer. Yet if we backtrack about a quarter of a century to the late 1980s, that wasn't the case. I mean, that's not the world I grew up in. That's not Colorado that I grew up in. Yet there was a handful of guys that were pushing forward, basically pioneers in this industry. Your family was one of them. Was that an exciting time, basically, when they were doing something nobody else was really venturing to do?
It's really nice to know that my grandpa kind of paved the way for a lot of modern day breweries. And, you know, starting it out back in 89, he really had a good niche of what he wanted, what he loved. Just kept going with it, made a good dream out of it.
That is fantastic. I mean, there's many aspects when it comes to the process of brewing, everything from milling the grain, making sure everything in the back room is correct, all the way to the final testing. Really, you can go back to the early 1900s. Your family's been involved in probably some aspect of it when you think about it.
My grandpa actually started in 89, but my great-great-grandpa actually had the biggest brewery in Michigan, the Michigan State Brewing Company, and he sold it to Goble Brewing, which is still open today. So even in the early 1900s, we were still going for it and trying to pave some way. We have some great brewers here. They kind of bring along the tradition that my grandpa actually brought in. We do brew them like he used to brew them, which is really nice, and it brings it in the 21st century, but still brings it back to the square roots, like where it started.
Brandon, this is in your blood, tradition of a trade. I mean, you're serious about brewing. It's an art that is perfected over time. I mean, it's really something you guys have been doing for many years. Speaking of time, this building is just a eking of time. Tell me why this is such a historical place to come in and have a taste.
Well, once we saw the place, we knew this was the face of Old Colorado Brewing Company Phase 2, the second brewery, that once we started it up, we needed a place that encompassed the history and the vision that we had, and this was the perfect spot.
Living it up while you're going down. 5 stories of grain elevator. I mean, man, it doesn't get too much better than this. This has to be a great place for people to come in, try some brew. When you guys first opened the doors, how did the public react?
We've had excellent feedback. We have a lot of regular people that come back every week. I think they were excited to see that we restored an old historic building, something that's been an icon in Wellington. They just love coming in and feeling at home here. It's very homey and comfortable, and also a lot of history.
Homey, comfortable, yet when you walk in here, you realize this is a little bit different than what people are used to. Not only looks different, feels different, it's built different. And we're talking about walls that were built to last. Tell me about that.
Well, they're 2x6s stacked on top of each other all the way up 5 stories, which is quite unique. Makes it very sturdy, beautiful. Once you see the inside, you can't really explain it. You have to see it to believe it.
That is right. The first thing I did as I walked in, had to start looking up. How many stories are we going up there?
We got 5 stories going all the way to the top. We have 2 sections in the brewery that put plexiglass in, so you can kind of feel the depth of the building. You know, it's just not one single floor. It's actually 5 stories, and you can see all the way up there.
You guys basically are packing some old-time values in every single bottle that you push out here. And we're talking about hard work, passion, obviously a little bit of fun. Puts all this in place, I would imagine. Let me ask you, is there a signature brew that started you guys out, or is there one that you're really well known for?
Well, we just released our Where Is Your Aspen? Originally, Aspen Ale from 1989 was the first brew that was brewed and released to the public in Fort Collins back in 1989. So we just released that in September. That's pretty much our signature that we have on tap right now, but we've got more to come.
Excellent. Speaking of more to come, tell me what the folks are going to find there on the back bar. Are you basically hosting some other beer places as well, or is this strictly all your own?
We strictly brew in-house. It is all our beer. It's all brewed on premises. We have capacity for 11 different taps, so we're going to have a bunch of different beers coming out. 6 staple beers, and they're going to be my grandpa's old recipes, but we still have more even to bring out as far as seasonals, you know, brewer's choice and things like that. We'll have 5 extra taps that we can kind of do some fun things with.
Tell me a little bit about your staff. I mean, the guys in the back room, I can see what goes on the front. People are having a great time, but obviously the magic happens behind the walls where the taste is found. Got a brewmaster that has some experience there. Everything's pretty much being done in the spirit of a German brewmaster. Tell me about the staff that makes it possible.
Well, technically right now I have 2 brewers. They're very good to us. They've been brewing for a long time. They've been doing some good things with our old beers and then as well as bringing out some great new beers. They're just small town guys, you know, they came and hung out with us. We tasted some beer and they really kicked it off with us. We had a good time ever since.
That is fantastic. But yet here in Colorado, we've almost become more sophisticated in our tasting. Are you able to taste the different variances?
Absolutely. I can taste a good beer and I can taste a great beer. I tend to like the dark beers, but I know that everybody has different taste buds. Everyone has a unique flavor, so it's exciting to go out and try all the different beers that are out there right now, including the ones that we have.
Excellent. Let me ask you, basically hasn't walked in here. They want to try out something for the first time. What would you recommend to them?
You know, I kind of talk to them, see what they like, see what they don't like, and then I can kind of assess what they want. Okay, we need a dark beer or a nice something maltier or, you know, something a little lighter with a little sweeter tones to it. And a lot of people around Colorado definitely know what they're looking for because we are such a beer society. They can come in here and I can kind of pinpoint something for them that they'd really like.
That is nice. Speaking of the folks that are coming through the doors here, obviously great taste. This is what flocks them all together, but this is really about community. This is a place where you bring people together, stories are told, people hang out. It might be a laid-back game night, or it might be a lively party where you got live music, maybe a food truck out front. Was that all part of the vision?
Oh, of course, you know, especially in Wellington because there's not a lot of stuff to do up here and we want to keep people and the community together all at one time, you know, bring new people in and come with the older guys that have been here for 30, 40 years. They all come together and they hang out and have some fun, listen to some good music, drink some beers, just have a good little time together and kind of mesh the old with the new.
Kind of cool for you to actually watch Wellington grow up with your business. I mean, Wellington was probably nothing 20, 30 years ago, and it's actually coming up to pace here, has a place here that has some great entertainment, some great food, and you're basically putting them on the map out there when it comes to beer. How's that make you feel?
It's incredible. You know, bringing back those old recipes to even a new clientele. We have some older guys that come in and say, hey, I like that porter you brewed or this, that, or the other. Bringing that in and giving it back to the community is just incredible.
Fantastic. Family tradition. Are you guys starting a family here?
Yep. We have a 4-year-old daughter and a 5.5-month-old daughter. So
here they come. The vision is alive and well. What do you think your grandfather would think if he walked through the doors today, took a look around and said, I'll be damned, you did something.
He's extremely proud. He's been a big fan of us ever since we started. Send him up stuff every now and again, and he just loves that we brought something back from the past. You know, his building really encompasses old Colorado, and that's what he loves.
Old Colorado, we're throwing you back to the past. Great historical building. Come in and check it out. Forward flavor here when it comes to beer, because we're putting out some of the best beer right here in Colorado. We're talking about a family tradition that began way back in the 1980s. A few handful of pioneers that brought it here to Colorado. I, for myself, this is the furthest north up we've come to check out a story, but I had to see this grain elevator for myself. Something quite unique to experience, but I definitely have to try some of this beer before I leave. Once again, this is Gary Atensi with CNTV. And if you don't know, now you know.